Welcome to yet another debate between Narendra Singh Sahu and Shoaib Syed Sahab. If you remember, a couple of weeks ago, maybe at the middle of December, we had a very interesting, at the same time, very, you know, encouraging debate between these two gentlemen, and they both conducted themselves very well and raised a lot of questions to each other, and they answered each other's questions very well. And in progression to that particular debate, in order to answer the questions raised by both sides and the questions that are not touched upon, we will be tackling those questions this evening. And Narendra Singh Sahu on my screen will be representing the Christian side of the discussion, and Shoaib Syed Sahab from Mumbai will be representing the Muslim side from on the same topic. The topic will not change. The topic is still the same: who is true God in the light of Quran and Bible and Islamic literature. So to continue with the discussion, let me invite both of them once again, and welcome Syed Sahab.
Hello, how are you?
Thank you, Syed Sahab. I'm doing good. Thank you very much for asking, and welcome Narendra Singh Sahu.
Thank you so much for having me back on the show, and thank you, Syed Sahab, for being there and for the second edition. Thank you again.
Perfect. So to continue with the discussion, last time we had, just to give you a little bit of background on what we have discussed and what we have agreed upon. When both of you were exchanging some of your ideas, you also invited each other on certain topics such as, Paul and Muhammad, who is the true prophet of God, and Muhammad, Syed Sahab agreed upon debating that particular topic as well, maybe in the future. But at the same time, we also had a few more questions raised, and then because of the lack of time, we could not answer all of those questions from both sides. So I thought, why don't we continue on this topic? And Syed Sahab agreed, and he actually persuaded me to have another program like this, and if the points are not completely covered, we can also have another episode of answering each other's questions, is what his idea was, and I agreed to that as well. So I invited Narendra Singh Sahu also, and he also agreed for that particular proposal, and now here we are actualizing that particular discussion that we had in private, and now we will be taking the questions that each contestant presented in front of the opponent, and we will probably take three or four questions and discuss them in detail rather than run around because of the lack of time. We will have solid time now, and we will be able to discuss those particular questions in much detail. So to begin with, let me open this debate with a 1 minute of question raised by Narendra Singh Sahu first, and then the second question will be from Shoaib Syed. Narendra Singh Sahu will ask the question in 1 minute, and for that Shoaib Syed will answer in 5 minutes. He will take 5 minutes and rebut his allegations or his claims or his questions that he raised in the past debate. But the only condition here that both the contestants, both the candidates agreed, is no new questions will be raised. All the questions will be from the previous debate presentation and previous debate discussion that we had in full length. So no question will be out of that debate syllabus, if we call that. So let's continue with that. So first, Christian side, Narendra Singh Sahu will ask one question within 1 minute, and Shoaib Syed will answer that question in 5 minutes, and then Narendra Singh Sahu will have another 5 minutes of time to rebut that explanation, and Shoaib Syed Sahab will take another 3 minutes to rebut his explanation, and again, we will give 3 minutes of conclusion time to Narendra Singh Sahu. So, everything put together, we will have five minutes of each and three minutes of each. So that is the format that we agreed. Are we on the same page?
Brother Praveen, yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, Syed Sahab.
Brother Praveen, we agreed that I will be questioning on the presentation and rebuttals of Brother Sahu.
Yes.
And he will be questioning on me on my presentation and rebuttal that I mentioned.
Yes.
So he cannot speak on any other thing. So he has to question me on the presentation that I presented and the rebuttals that I gave.
Yes, that's exactly what we will be doing. Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Go ahead, Narendra Singh.
Okay, thank you again to Rakshana TV for this wonderful opportunity to be there and take this lively discussion ahead. So as a part of my the first presentation that I had made a claim and proven also, but again, we come back to it. That is, Islam is deeply rooted in pagan practices. Everything of Islam is from pagan background. So there is the Kaaba, there is the fasting on the 10th of Muharram, the 1 month fasting, the tawaf between Safa and Marwa, even the Zamzam part. Fasting for 10 days, praying towards Mecca, cutting the hair, everything, circumambulating around the Kaaba, everything has got pagan practices. So the question that I had asked you the last time and awaiting a response to that is, how could a God, which is supposed to be setting everything right, take up everything and house it around pagan practices, including circumcision, as I had said the last time?
Okay, so that's your question. Thank you very much. Sayyid Saab.
This was not in my presentation. This was not in my rebuttal. Why is asking a question out of my rebuttal and what out of my presentation?
This is his presentation and he is asking you the same question which you did not answer.
This is his presentation and I am going to answer this question in due time. But why he is asking me outside my presentation and rebuttals? He should ask me question on my presentation and rebuttals. He is not asking me question on my presentation and rebuttals.
No, he is asking you a question in the entire debate that he asked you, and you.
Yeah, this is what I'm saying. He's asking a question, the same question that he asked me.
Yes.
I'm telling he can ask me question on my presentation and my rebuttals. I will be asking him question on his presentation and his rebuttals.
Okay, we can do that also, but you take time and answer his question, and while doing that you can also raise questions on his presentation, not problem.
Agree to this condition, no, that I will be asking about question on his presentation and his rebuttals.
The agreed condition is his presentation and your presentation, you both own those presentations. He will raise questions that are not answered from his presentation, and you will raise questions that are not answered from your presentation, and both of you will have opportunity to, you know, answer. That is exactly what you discussed.
That's what I had typed back, because what is happening is that you had said that I had not answered any of your questions.
Correct.
And same thing that what even I had said, that is from the Quranic side, you answered nothing. So in that case, that is the whole purpose of the second session. That is, you get to hear the answers which you think I haven't answered, and I get to raise the same questions, exactly the same questions, nothing more, what I did raise the last time, and you get the opportunity to respond in detail.
And instead, you can also raise questions. You can also raise questions. Yes, you can also raise questions.
No, I have prepared all the rebuttals, all the refutations. Only that I have to find the proper slide now.
Okay, take time, Zab. We have time, no issues. And proper slides.
So what was his question?
His question is, the roots of the Islam are in pagan practices. How come?
Want me to repeat it?
Okay. Yes. Okay. I got the slide.
Yeah.
So you said your seventh question was Narendra Sahu. You asked the seventh question. This was the seventh question. Are the rituals not pagan practice? Am I right?
Yes, they are. Yes. So you can have your go ahead.
Okay.
Yes, please.
So I'm now saying, no, they are not. They are not pagan practice. Abraham, Moses, Joshua, Jesus, angels, all did fall on their faces and prayed to God. They all prostrated. The way Muslims pray, they prayed also. Abraham, Moses, Joshua, Jesus, angels, and all angels did fall on their faces and prayed to God. Genesis chapter 17. So, Abraham prayed like Muslims. Numbers chapter 20, verse number 6. Moses and Aaron fell on their faces and prayed to God. Joshua chapter 5, verse number 4. Joshua fell on his face and to the earth and did worship. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse number 39. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, "The Lord, He is the God. The Lord, He is the God." So people also prostrated and prayed like Muslims. Matthew chapter 26, verse number 39. Jesus fell on his face and prayed to God. He prostrated and prayed to God. Revelation chapter 7, verse number 11. And all the angels stood around and about the elders and the four beasts and fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped God. So are these pagan practices, dear Narendra Sahu? They all fell on their faces and prayed to God like Muslims fall on their faces and pray to God. This is not pagan practice. This is from your Bible. Now, Exodus chapter 40, verse 21. The ablution. We Muslims perform the ablution. And Moses and Aaron and his sons washed their hands and their feet thereat. So Moses and Aaron, they performed ablution. Zephaniah chapter 3, verse number 9. Zephaniah chapter 3, verse number 9. For then will I turn to the people a pure language, that they may call upon the name of the Lord to serve Him with one unison. Shechem. Shoulder to shoulder. Who prays throughout the world in one language except Muslim? Who prays throughout the world except Muslim? Who calls out Azan call for prayer 5 times daily throughout the world and it's on continuously? And who prays joining shoulder to shoulder in the mosque but Muslims? We Muslims pray in the mosque joining shoulder to shoulder. This is exactly given in Zephaniah chapter 9. To serve Him with one unison, Shechem, shoulder to shoulder. Are these pagan practice? This is from Bible. The people in the Bible, they practice all these things. Nehemiah chapter 8, verse number 6. And Israel the scribe stood upon a pulpit of wood, which they had made for the purpose. This is exactly the member in the mosque that we have. And beside him stood Mithiah, and Shema, and Ananiah, and Phrygia, and Hilkiah, and Mithiah on his right hand. This is how we have people standing on the right hand, and people standing on the left hand, on his left hand. Pedaya and Michelle, Hilchia and Hashem and Hashabitina, Zachariah and Meshulam. And Israel opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. The people all stand up. And Israel blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, "Amen, Amen," with lifting up their hand. We also lift our hand between Raphaim. And they bowed their head and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. They all bowed down. Also fall down, we also fall on their faces in the past and pray to God. Practice. Muslims are doing all these things. Are they pagan practice? How? These are not pagan practice. This is in their Bible too. Psalms chapter 84, verse number 4. It speaks about the Makkah. Blessed is the man who dwells in the city, in whose heart are the way of them. Who passing the valley of Makkah, make it a well, the rain to fill it up. Psalms chapter 84, verse 43. Quran also mentions in chapter 3, verse number 90. Indeed, the first house of worship established for mankind was that at Makkah, blessed and guided the world. The word Makkah is in Psalms in Bible. The word Makkah is in the Quran. Are these pagan practice, dear Narendra Sahu? They are not pagan practice. Now, history of running between Safa and Marwa is in remembrance of Hajra, wife of Abraham. Wife of Abraham, Genesis chapter 52 mentions that Hajra was the wife of Abraham. Running for water for thirsty, crying baby Ishmael on the floor at Makkah. So it is in remembrance of Hajra, the wife of Abraham, Hajra. She was running between Marwa and we Muslims in Hajj. This is not a pagan practice. This is practice of Hajra. We are remembering Hajra, the wife of Abraham. Genesis chapter 16, verse number 3. Fasting, 10th Muharram, pagan practice at all. Prophet Muhammad saw the Jews fasting on the day in remembrance of Moses. Prophet made it, recommended to fast 2 days in remembrance of Moses. Is the 10th Muharram or 10th or 11th Muharram? So how can it be a pagan practice? Simulating in remembrance of Moses. How can it be a pagan practice? This is not a pagan practice. Luke chapter 2, verse number 21. When it was eight days was accomplished for the circumcision of the child, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived. So circumcision is not a pagan practice. Jesus himself was circumcised. Jesus was himself circumcised. Genesis chapter 17, verse number 13 and 14. He that is born in the house, and he that is born, brought to the family, must eat be circumcised. And my covenant shall be in your flesh an everlasting covenant. And the uncircumcised man, flesh of his foreskin, if not circumcised, that soul shall be cut off from his people. He hath broken my covenant. So if you are circumcised, you are under covenant. If you are not circumcised, you have broken the covenant. This is the token of the covenant. Muslims have it, Christians do not have it. Muslims are circumcised, therefore they have the covenant. Christians are not circumcised, so they do not have the covenant. Is this a pagan practice? I'm asking you. Is this a pagan practice?
Syed sir, time up.
Abraham was circumcised.
Syed sir, time up.
Conclusion. Okay.
Sure. And just to remind both of you guys, please, have your microphone pretty close to your mouth. All through Syed Saab's presentation, Syed Saab, probably is it, I don't know whether it is because of your beard or something else, but there was a lot of disturbance, but somehow we could manage it. Try and keep, if it is...
I had the disturbance of rebounding, listening my voice again and again, the same thing.
Yeah. There is some issue, but we will figure that out while Sahu's presentation is on. Sahu, it's time for you. 5 minutes of rebuttal, please. Go ahead.
One sec. I'll just pull up at that point. Okay. Yeah. Shall we?
Yes.
Praveen, one quick favor. Just give me a time up at 3 minutes and then 1 minute, please. Can you do that?
Yes, I'll do that.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
All right. So I've heard this utter garbage from Zakir Naik. I always wanted to throw it back. And so this is a great opportunity. So all fell on their faces and prayed. Okay. Show me a single instance in the Old Testament or in the New Testament where there is a specific format. You do calisthenics, you know, that yoga type postures that you do. Probably you stole it from Hindus. So because they also do that Surya Namaskar, standing up, and there's a sequence, you can't break that sequence. They all fell on their face because of respect and fear for God. Did they get up, bow their head, do this, that, touching the ear, face, nose, on the ground, everything? Do they do that? They don't do that. They are not following in that way. There is out of sheer admiration, love, respect and fear, which you don't know. You are basically slaves. We treat God as Father. You will never understand that. You Muslims are slaves to God. From the Old Testament to the New, God has given the unique privilege to be called Father. He called Israel, everybody, we are adopted in his family as children. So that is something. So I challenge you, show me the calisthenics that you do in the Old Testament or in the New Testament. Standing shoulder to shoulder, the best example I'll give you, it happens in our church. We all brothers, sisters, we don't sit separate, sister somewhere else, brother somewhere else, because somebody might get some basic feeling in the head. That doesn't happen. So we all sit together. It doesn't happen like sisters sitting somewhere else and men sitting somewhere else. We all stand together. We all praise to God. That is what was happening. Some people even fall on the ground and pray. Even I have done that sometimes. But it was not a compulsion. It was not a formula. I'm not a slave. I'm a child of God. That is something you'll never understand. And I hope you do before your time is up. So this is a definite pagan practice. I'll show you from where it is. Now, same thing, shoulder to shoulder, Zephaniah, Nehemiah, utter rubbish. Now, you said Psalm, some verse, you said your voice was cracking very badly. I challenge you, show me where Mecca is written. The house of prayer was Jerusalem. The house of prayer was Jerusalem, not Mecca. Yes. What Muhammad did as a political move, he first made the Qibla as Jerusalem. And then when he realized that the Jews didn't accept him as a true prophet, they knew he was a fake prophet, they rejected him. And once he went back to Medina, he declared the Qibla as Mecca. So it was a political move. So what you were doing, the smooching of the black stone, show me the smooching of the black stone in as a practice. And you are going, Muslims go circumambulate around the Kaaba, show that as a practice in the Old Testament and the New and in the New Testament. So here, there is seven times you go around. Why you know that, Mr. Syed? Because at that time, at the time of Muhammad, they thought there were seven planets. So to pacify the seven planets, they would go seven times around the Kaaba. Your Qibla is the Kaaba. You bow down, you fall, and you do all the calisthenics pointing towards the Kaaba. You are worshipping the black stone. You are a stone worshipper, same like the Hindus.
2 minutes.
So circumcision is not a pagan practice. Circumcision is not a really. The commandment to get circumcised is on the 8 days, on the 8th day. Show me that commandment in your Quran. Secondly, is that the horrible practice of female genital manipulation, of the female circumcision, it is there in Islam, a horrific, horrific practice. You don't even treat your women as women. Show me that in the Old Testament. This is an Egyptian practice which Muhammad stole. So what you have as circumcision is a pagan practice of Egyptian. It is a Chinese copy of the practice of the Egyptian. So your circumcision is a Chinese ripoff of Egyptian practices, not the Jewish practices. Now, why I didn't get circumcised? Because that, as per what the book of Genesis, it was to the generations of Abraham. I'm not from the generation of Abraham. I'm not a Jew. If I was a Jew, I would get circumcised. If you read the book of Acts chapter 15, which is the first council of Jerusalem, there you will see that they all decide the Jews can still get circumcised and the non-Jews need not get circumcised, because the covenant was with the genealogy of Abraham only. That is why Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, your Lord and Savior, Muhammad's Lord and Savior, got circumcised because he was a Jew. I am not, because I am a child of God. I am not a slave of God. I'm adopted into the family of Jesus Christ, and I'm not circumcised because I don't need to.
Thank you.
I think my time's up.
Thank you. Yes. Yes. Shoaib Saab, you have 2 minutes to rebut.
Yeah, he's talking rubbish. He's talking utter rubbish when I'm giving him references from the Bible that Abraham was circumcised, Jesus was circumcised, Paul circumcised Timothy. How can you say it is a pagan practice? It is not a pagan practice, it is a sunnah of Abraham. It is sunnah of Abraham. Now you say, well, show me Makkah. I showed you Makkah in the Bible. I showed you Makkah in the Bible, 84, Psalms 84, chapter 4 to 6. And I showed you from Quran, chapter 3, verse number 96, Makkah, the same word. The original name was Makkah, not Makkah. Makkah, Makkah, I showed you from the Bible. Then you started with Qibla. Qibla is not the topic. Qibla is not the topic here. Why you want to show me Qibla? Smooching of the black stone, I already gave you reply. Smooching of the black stone, we don't smooch, we don't kiss the black stone as a deity. You, the Hindus, they smooch, they kiss the black stone as a deity. We don't smooch, we don't kiss the black stone as a deity. It is a practice, a sunnah of Prophet Muhammad that he kissed, therefore we kiss. We kiss our children. We kiss our wives. Are we worshipping our children and we are wives? We don't worship children and wives. We just kiss them. So kissing is not worship. Circumambulation, you say, the pagan. Circumambulation was started by Moses, by Abraham. In the Quran, I have the reference. In the Quran, God Almighty commanded Abraham to circumambulate the Kaaba. So circumambulation was started by Abraham. It was continued by the pagans. Pagans continued it naked. They were absolutely naked. Prophet Muhammad continued with the circumambulation of Abraham al-Salam, but avoided the pagan practice of nakedness. We did not go naked. Now you say, show me 8 days of circumcision. Why I should show you circumcision in the Quran? There is no condition in the Quran or Hadith that circumcision should be mentioned in the Quran. It is not a condition.
Time up, Saab.
So it is not a pagan. It is not a pagan practice. I am not a Jew. He said it is not a Jew. A question of
time
Jew.
Up. Time
Those
up,
who are bought out of the Jews, they were also circumcised in Genesis chapter 17, verse number 13, 14.
Sayed Saab, time up. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. 2 minutes for you to rebut.
Okay, the first thing, he says, kissing is not worship. Of course not. Even I kiss my children, but I never bow down in front of them and worship and pray. Pointing towards them, I don't see, okay, where is my child? Then I point towards that and I pray. That is worship. So that is what you are doing because you are a pagan practicer. And as I said earlier, show me the female genital mutilation, the female circumcision as a part of the Jewish practice. You are following a cheap copy of Egyptian circumcision practice. And as I said earlier, Acts chapter 15, Jerusalem Council, it was decided that, okay, the Jews would be continuing to get circumcised. Non-Jews would not. That's why we don't get circumcised. Now, last but not the least, Makkah is Makkah. Seriously? An 8-year-old won't talk like this. This is Vakka is Makka. Can you give me any evidence? I challenge you to that. We can take this up again, this question in the second round also if you want. I challenge you. Show me Vakka is Makka. Now coming to, you asked me for sources. Okay, Alfred Guillaume, he wrote from the first tradition by the first Muslim biographer, Ibn Ishaq. Now I'm just quickly summarizing over here. Here it is, the four sacred months has been considered during the pre-Islamic period. Even that was a part of pagan practice. As a part of the pagan practices, even the major Hajj, the Hajj Umrah, circumambulation, Kaaba, seven times around Safa Marwa, throwing rocks, washing after intercourse, gargling, sniffing water up the noses, clipping fingernails, plucking hair from the armpits, shaving the pubic hair, performed the rites of circumcision like this. Even the cutting of the right hand of a thief was written as a pagan practice by your own Islamic scholar Muhammad Ibn Abdul Karim al-Shastrin in his Al-Milal Wal Nihil. He is a historian who has said that. The Salat, he took 30 seconds more, man.
Time
okay,
up.
The Saviors Time also up. Had five prayers for the Muslims.
Time up.
All pagan.
Time up. Thank you. Time up. Well, thank you, gentlemen. I just, recommend all of you to just keep the timing, both of you to keep the timing. And Syed Saab, I'll take a quick 1 minute break only for you because your screen is, completely frozen. We can't see you. We can see your face, which is, which is a catch from previous minutes, but right now it is completely frozen. Your second rebuttal was also completely frozen, but we could hear only your voice. So I'll give you time to set your system up. I'll just take a break of 2 minutes and we'll start again. Thank you.
जो साथ कभी न टूटी वो साथ है यीशु
Welcome back to the big debate that we're having this evening, and both the gentlemen, were patient enough to answer each other, and I would recommend both of you, gentlemen, to stick to the time and also do your best to stick to the topic itself. So now it's time for Shueb Syed Sahab to ask his question in 1 minute.
Okay. My approach to the topic was to quote the verses with references and contents, explanations, and then conclusions before the audience to witness. And your approach to the topic was to give the references, verse numbers, and directly your conclusion without actually giving the contents and explanation of the verses. This is how you rattled off hundreds of references with one or two words of conclusions. Few times references, question. Verse numbers do not exist.
Questions up.
And most of the time your conclusions are based and wrong, biased and wrong. Narendra Sahu, why you were cheating and doing fecology like this?
Is that your question? Okay.
My question is, Narendra Sahu, why you were cheating and doing fecology like this? Without verse numbers, few times the verse numbers did not exist. Your conclusions are most of the time biased and wrong. Why you are doing fecology like this?
I will direct this question to Narendra Singh Sahu if he wants to respond to that. I don't mind him doing that, but I would not consider that as part of the syllabus that we agreed. So you can respond in a couple of minutes, and I'll give another chance to Dr. Shueb Syed for an actual question from the topic. Please refrain, to the topic. Please refrain going outside of the topic. Please stay inside the topic. I'll give 2 minutes to Narendra Singh Sahu to respond to that question and come back to Shueb Sahab for an actual question. Please, Narendra.
Okay, this is really amazing. What are you saying? Okay, so that is the whole point, Shueb Sahab. I'm not saying that I did wrong in any manner, because I gave references for everything. I spoke a bit fast, and since this whole purpose of this second debate that I agreed was that so that you get a fair chance to respond. This is something that you would never do. And that is what I have done. I've given you a fair chance to respond. So you have the chance, so take it, because Praveen has been very gracious. And if you're saying that I've misquoted some words, then show it, right? If you're saying I'm biased, then show it. That is what the whole purpose is. If you say that I am biased somewhere, prove it. Then I will show you how it is a bias or not a bias, or whether I'm being hypocritical or you are being pagan. So we can check all that.
Okay.
So for all these things, the verses are there.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. For an actual question, Syed Saab, over to you. In 1 minute, if you can please ask an actual question from the topic.
You want another question? This question was not enough.
It was not enough because it was not in line with the topic that we both agreed.
Okay, fine. You started your presentation complaining that Sam Shamoon had already replied the same of repeated questions against Christianity raised by Ahmed Didar, Dr. Zakir Naik, etc. Dr. Shueb is just repeating the same. If Sam Shamoon and you have attempted to answer our questions, do not assume you have answered them satisfactorily. They are actually not answered. Example, Isaiah chapter 53. My question is, Mr. Narendra Sahu, why quote Isaiah 53 when rising back from the dead, the third day, not mentioned in Isaiah 53? Rising back from the dead, the third day, is not mentioned in Isaiah 53. Why you quote Isaiah 53 for that? So
right.
The question that you attempt to answer, it is not answered at all.
Sure. So the question, let me reframe it. The question, to bring it back into the topic, Isaiah 53, you quoted in your presentation, but it does not speak anything about the resurrection of Jesus. And then how did you quote it? 5 minutes for your rebuttals.
One sec. Okay, first of all, okay, I'm just pulling that up, Isaiah 53.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is amazing. Actually, I'll prove again that Sam had answered it, and I'll prove again that how being, who you are unable to understand it because you have a very strong bias against it. So the verse in question, I can't get directly to the point, so I'm not wasting time like you. So, 53 verse 9 and 10. 9 would be, he was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. That is the crucifixion, the death which the Islam somehow against all evidence and history refuses to understand. Anyway, yet it was verse 10. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life a guilt offering, he will see his offspring and prolong his days. How? This is what Sam asked you. If he can see his offspring, how can he do that if he is not come back to life? And prolong his days. If he is already dead in verse 9, what prolonging of days was he talking about? And the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After death, what will of the Lord will prosper in his hand? Then after the suffering of his soul, listen to this, verse 11, please make a note of that, Mr. Sayed. After the suffering of his soul, he'll see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many. How can he justify after he is just dead if he is not even resurrected? And he will bear their iniquities. So verse 9, he'll bear the iniquities, the judgment, he will die. Verse 10 and 11, he'll bear the iniquities, he'll come back to life. And his days will be prolonged and he'll see his offspring. Now, I know where you're coming to and I have a choice of allowing you to waste your time or continuing. So I will continue. So you are basically saying, I'm sure that you would say, that offspring, did Jesus have any offspring? But see, the problem, Mr. Sayed, is that unfortunately, you being a Muslim, you cannot think beyond the physical self. You cannot think in the bigger way, in the metaphysical way. For you, as an Islam, it is all about sex, children, physical. But again, that is where it is. So the word used over here, zera, seed, is called zera. So here it is. First, the word zera is used in a spiritual and or a metaphorical manner. So our sinful nation, that is, you see that in Isaiah 1 verse 4, a people laden with iniquity, a seed, same word is used, a seed of evildoers, zera of evildoers. Verse 14, verse 20 of Isaiah, the seed of evildoers, the word uses zera. Now, the next point, I've got many such verses, but to save time, Praveen, how much time I have? Now, Isaiah does not say that the servant will see his own seed. It simply says that the servant will see his seed. And we see that again in, we see that yet it pleased the Hashem. We see that in the Orthodox Jewish Bible that he put him to suffering when thou shalt make him nephesh and Hashem, that is an offering for sin. And he, that is the Moshiach, the Messiah, will see Zera. And the same word is there in Psalm 16 and in John 1:12 also. And he shall prolong his Yamim days and his chaftes Hashim, pleasure, will of Hashim, that is in again in Hebrew, shall prosper in his, that is Messiah's hand. This is there in the Orthodox Jewish Bible, and this brings us to the third point. Very important, please pay attention. According to Isaiah, Yahweh has sworn to save and justify, that is make righteous, the seed of his people Israel. And we see that again in Isaiah, same book, Isaiah 45 verse 18 to 25. The seed of Jacob, Zera. It is not every time about the sex and everything here only. It is also in the metaphysical sense. And then Isaiah 53 also explains the way in which Yahweh will do this by having his servant, Jesus Christ, die as a vicarious sacrifice for all sins. And we see that again in Isaiah 53 verse 10 to 11, he shall see his seed, Zera, and then going down to verse 11, justify many, yastit la rabim in Hebrew, for he shall bear his iniquities. And then again, we see that in the book of Psalms, which confirms this interpretation. And we see that in Psalm chapter 22, which is a messianic psalm, Dr. Sayed, Psalms 22 verse 19 to 31, I will declare thy name unto my brethren, in the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. And then going down, all ye, the seed of Jacob, Zera, seed Jacob, Zera, all ye, the seed Zera of Israel, a seed shall come,
right,
a seed shall serve it. Sorry.
Time up. Sides up, 5 minutes.
Isaiah chapter 53 does not speak about coming back from the dead the third day. I'm emphasizing what Paul is saying, and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. So this particular statement that he rose from the dead the third day is not there in the Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 was spoken when it was spoken. When it was written, Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 was written 800 BC. So if in the 8th century BC, the statement is like this. I'm reading verse number 9. Isaiah 53, verse number 9. And he was taken from prison. He was taken from prison when? It was before 8th century BC, long back. It is not in future. It is taken from prison. And from the judgment he shall declare his generation. For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked. When he made this grave? Before 8 BC, before 740 BC. All the books of Isaiah, 66 books of Isaiah was written in 740 BC. So if it was written 740 BC, this is all in past tense. All in past tense means that it is before 800 BC, before 8th century BC. So it is not referring in future. It is not referring for Jesus Christ is upon him. And I repeat that coming back from the dead the third day, this statement is not there in Isaiah 53. And it is not there in any of the Old Testament books. It is not there. So it is not true that the statement is there. So Isaiah, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 3, 4 says that he was buried and he rose again the third day according to the scripture. This statement is not there. So you can't say anything that it is there in the scripture. This is all I have to say.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. 2 minutes of response from your side.
So, Dr. Sayed, again, I don't blame you. It's unfortunately you're following a fake prophet, because you should understand it, because a prophecy means future tense. That doesn't happen because you are following Muhammad. It is all about past tense and me, myself, and my physical body. So this is a prophecy hundreds of years in the past. That is the whole point. Even historians are stunned and they want to. And there was even some theories that the book of Isaiah was not written 800 BC because it is so accurately prophetic by nature. Book of Isaiah, book of Daniel. But again, you will not understand. You need to look for a proper prophet. Give up Muhammad, give up Allah. You need to look for a proper God who is omnipotent, not impotent. And you need to look for a prophet who can actually make prophecies. And that is the reason you don't understand. Isaiah is a prophetic book. It is written about the future. Now, again, you're coming up with the exact word criterion. On what basis? Earlier, now you changed the goalpost. Earlier, you said, where is the resurrection in the Old Testament? I showed you in Hebrew. And now you're saying, show me 3 days. Then you'll say, show me that after 3 days, he will wake up in that skull tomb. What? My God is not my bellboy, like Allah is the bellboy of Muhammad, that whatever he says, he'll come and repeat. My God does what he does. I have to understand it in that context. So in that case, every prophecy is in the past tense. So tell me, what is the meaning of the word prophet then? Come on, Dr. Sayed, you seem to be a good person. Don't go with this garbage. To justify a defenseless position of Allah and what he says, you are making up all these stories. You seem to be an intelligent person. Had he not been following Allah, he would have done probably something better in life. So all this 800 years before, yes, hallelujah to my Lord and risen Savior. It is accurate. Otherwise, tell me, okay, let me go by your yardstick. If you are saying it was for that time, show me any person at the time of Isaiah when he was living. Give me evidence right now that that person lived and was born. He died and then he rose away, rose again. I could see his offspring and he could see prosperity. Show me.
Yeah, time up. 2 minutes rebuttal for you, Sayed Saab. You are not visible, but we'll leave with that for now. Please, go ahead. 2 minutes for you. Okay. Looks like Sayed Saab is not, he's not no more in connection with us. Let's take a 2 minute break and we'll come back quickly.
The prophecy worked.
జగమే ఊగింది ఒక ఊయలై జగతిలో యేసు జన్మించగా
So welcome back. There were some technical glitches from, you know, because of the connectivity anyways, but we have both the guests now with us, and the last comments made by Narendra Singh Sahu for 2 minutes were unheard by Dr. Shuaib Syed. So I would request Narendra Singh Sahu to repeat his rebuttals of 2 minutes, and then I'll give 2 minutes of time to Shuaib Syed. Over to you, 2 minutes, Narendra.
This is like a live action replay. Okay, but anyway, so here goes. Okay, now this is actually hilarious because you are saying that, okay, Isaiah was written 800 in the past, so hallelujah and praise be to my God and your God, of course, whom we don't accept, is that a prophecy, it can be in the past tense, in the future tense also. That is what is meant by the word of it. Of course, you are not aware of it, of how a prophecy works, because your prophet was a fake prophet. He couldn't talk properly even about the past. So he got many historical things wrong, theological things totally messed up. And then how can he talk about the future? So that is where Isaiah, being a true prophet of God, he could predict, he could speak about the future based upon the power of God on him. That is why the chapter starts with, and the word of the Lord came to him, or thus says the Lord. So it is not thus says me, it says thus says the Lord. Now, coming to this thing, Isaiah was written 800 years in the past before Jesus Christ. And we still have, copies of the book of Isaiah like 200 years before Christ, 300 years before Christ, still accurate till date. And historians have even raised a possible allegation that possibly Isaiah was not written 800 years in the past because it's so accurate about the future. Same thing for Isaiah, same thing for Daniel. Mr. Syed, you need a proper prophet, or you need a proper God. Give up Islam, a fake prophet and a fake God. So this is what a prophecy is all about. It's about the future. Now let me take your line, and you are saying that it was for that time. Fine. I'll challenge you. I've given you the verses. Show me one person at the time of Isaiah who said, who lived, who died, rose up, saw prosperity, and his children and his offspring also, whether physical, because you understand physical, or metaphysical, which I understand. So that is also fine with me. You can go for that. And you know, last but not the least is that, of course, the 600 years, 66 books of Isaiah. When was Isaiah written? This is all, you know, you have to understand how the prophecy works. And that's what I can say. Come over to Christ, you will see what a prophecy is all about.
Right.
Thank you.
Time up. Thank you. 2 minutes for you. Say it's up.
Yeah, this is what you will say, that the prophecy can be made in future, in past tense. Why should the prophecy should be made in past tense? If it prophecies about future, it should be in future tense. But Isaiah 53 doesn't start with Isaiah 53. You start with Isaiah 52. Start with Isaiah 52, what it says. I'm reading. Awake, awake, put on thy strength, O Zion. What is Zion? Zion is a mountain in Jerusalem. Awake, awake, put on thy strength, O Zion. Put on thy beautiful garments. Why thy beautiful garment? Why singular word, thy? Thy word is used for Jerusalem. Thy word is used for Zion. So it is not regarding individual person. It is speaking about Jerusalem itself. And again you read, the holy city for henceforth, there shall no more come into thee, the uncircumcised and the unclean. Shake thyself from the dust. Arise at dawn, O Jerusalem, shake thyself. So it is speaking to the Jerusalem, not to an individual person, human being. So it is a Jerusalem. Loose thyself from the bands of thy neck. So the whole story is about Jerusalem, not an individual person. And I said, the prophecy of Paul is that he shall be buried and he shall rise again the third day according to the scriptures. Rise again the third day. The third day is not there in your Isaiah 53. Third day is not there in all your Old Testament. The prophecy about coming back to life is not there in the whole Old Testament. If any prophecy of back to life is there in the Old Testament, this will be amazing thing. This will be amazing. It will be a news in the Old Testament. And this is not true for Jewish, in a Jewish book.
Time up.
A Jewish book cannot be in a Jewish book like that. It is a cursed person. It's a cursed person.
Time up. Well, you know, after repeated attempts, looks like Shoaib Saab, your screen is freezing up. If you agree to continue the discussion without you, you know, live on, you know, lively visible, we can continue. Otherwise, we'll have to look for better infrastructure, better, you know, better way of doing it. You know, your screen again froze up. 2-3 seconds after you started speaking. So for some reason, this is, this is kind of very difficult to continue. But if you are okay with only voice, then we will continue with this discussion. What do you say? Are you there? Can you hear me?
Yeah, man.
Are you there? Can you hear me? Syed Saab. Okay, so gentlemen, thank you so much. It is a hard, you know, it is very hard if the connectivity and the technology doesn't work. But if Syed Saab can, you know, fix that a little bit, and if he can be on, then we will continue. Syed Saab, can you hear me?
I can hear you, yes.
Yes, Syed Saab, thank you very much for rejoining us. Now it's time for Narendra Singh, question for Narendra Singh Sahu to question you. This is the third question that we're taking. Probably with this question, depending on the connectivity and depending on how your screen works, if it doesn't freeze, we'll continue the discussion. Narendra Singh Sahu, 1 minute for you to ask the question, please.
Okay, again, this is a point that I touched on fleeting, and I found it unfair that you were unable to answer it the last time, so I'm taking it up again. That is, as I've shown in my first question, that everything about Islam is pagan, and Muhammad was a very political guy. So he made decisions based on politics. So here also we see that in Surah chapter 53, Al-Najm in 53, 19, 20, 21, 22, which is also called as the Satanic Verses. Many people think that it was Salman Rushdie who made it. No, Salman Rushdie just pointed it out, and it was there. Not just by Salman Rushdie, all the Islamic scholars also pointed to it and had shown what was going on. So here we see that Satan speaks through Muhammad. So, and then, that is the Satanic Verses that is all about. And then we see also that Muhammad was demon-possessed going on. So my question to Dr. Sayed is, if a prophet, so-called prophet, your prophet, what we call as prophet, is unable to distinguish between what is right and what is wrong, and he doesn't even know how to control his tongue and know that this cannot be from Allah, how can you trust the whole Quran, even though like he was there for 6-8 months, something, he was demon-possessed. So how can you trust anything that he says? That's my question.
Right. Sayed Saab. Sides up. 5 minutes for you to answer.
He spoke so many things about Satanic Verses. Satanic Verses was not discussed in the last presentation. He's going out of the topic again.
Satanic Verses was part of his presentation, if you recollect. He did present it.
What? Satanic Verses was not presented.
Okay.
I touched on
it. So I have everything.
As I said, he uttered the Satanic Verses. And what I'll do is that when I host it on my channel, I'll put that clip also over there. It is there. I have made my promise to you. I will not defy it.
Okay. Why don't we? It is Narendra Singh Sahu's contention that he presented it, but you're saying he did not. But let's go to another question and we can come back in the next episode if it is possible.
What was your question? You said that okay. If he was under the influence of demon, how can we trust him?
What he's saying is, if the Prophet cannot distinguish between the words of Allah and words of Satan, how can you trust the Quran? In that case, how can you trust Allah Himself who decreed this to happen? This is the question.
Okay. See, the story of Satanic Verses is a false story. It is a false hadith regarding that Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not recognize. This is a false story. The hadith's narration is a false story. It is fabricated one. So we don't believe those hadiths which are fabricated, which says that it was Satanic Verses. It was not Satanic Verses. Prophet Muhammad was affected by magic, but he was treated also. He was treated miraculously. If you are sick, if you are affected, after treatment, you can correct everything what you have. But under influence of magic, he was not influenced religiously. Everything influenced was worldly aspects. Nothing was influenced on a religious aspect. So whatever revelation came, it was not affected at all. And magic happened in Medina. Good portion of the Quran was revealed in Makkah. And after the magic also, he was healed. He was cured. After curing, you can again correct what you have missed, anything in that case. So magic and this thing cannot affect the revelation. Revelation was perfect, and we can prove to you that Quran is the revelation from God scientifically, logically, and perfectly, inshallah.
Okay. 5 minutes rebuttal to you.
1 minute, Praveen.
Yes.
Sayed Saab, actually, I'll answer it now. And if you wish, if you think that things are not fair, we can always take up the same question again in the next time.
Yes, yes.
So I'm all okay with it. Okay. Yes, I want to be very fair with you. I don't want you to think that I pulled a fast one on you.
No. We can give fair time to Sayed Saab next time also if he wants to come prepared.
Yes, Sayed Saab, if you think that you're not aware of what I'm talking about or something, no offense to you. I'm okay for doing the same question again in the next time.
Yes, please go ahead and rebut what he said. He's just saying that it is a fabricated story. It's a false hadith. It's a fabricated hadith.
Okay. Now, this is something like the same question was asked to his mentor also, Zakir Naik, and he said it was a fabrication done by the mushriks of Medina, and he just made some face and turned away. So that is a Muslim apologist practice, because this was the most embarrassing part of Muhammad's prophetic career. Now, I'm sure that he would regret it even later on. But anyway, so I'm reading from, if you refer to Ibn Ishaq, the earliest biography of Muhammad, I'm not talking about, something written hundreds of years beyond Muhammad, like the Hadith. This was Ibn Ishaq written within a few years of Muhammad. And he says, let me just quickly rephrase it. It's on page number 165 and you know, 166. And what we see is that Muhammad was preaching in Mecca. He didn't mean many converts. And since he wouldn't stop condemning the religious belief of Mecca, they started persecuting him. And as the suffering increased, Muhammad longed for a revelation from God because he wanted to bring about peace. You know, he wanted to rule. He was a politically very sharp guy, needed lots of money, lots of babes. So what to do? So he came up with a new revelation suddenly, just in time, words from Muhammad, from Allah, because Allah was sitting there for Muhammad to give a verse. And he gave, have you not heard of Allah, Al-Uzza and Al-Manar? This is the same thing what I said in my first presentation, the last debate. That is, these are the daughters of Ubal, who is aka Allah. Then these are the exalted brains whose intercession is hoped for. And then we see, are yours the males and his the females? That indeed was an unfair division. Now there is no explanation anywhere about what the heck is this all about? What is the meaning of this verse? And they say this was like an interjection by the devil. But that is not the case. Actually, if you read the verse 21 and 22, it says, are yours the males and his the females? And Allah is not upset. That, you know, like in the first debate, Shoaib said that Allah is neither begotten, neither begated, doesn't have a son, daughter, these, that. But here he has three daughters. And what Allah is saying that, oh, so you are giving me daughters and no sons for me. So Allah is actually jealous. So, and then that is what is there. And you know how many references are there with regards to this, you know, as they say, there is a fabrication. Can you take a quick guess? Like, is there 1, 2, 5, 10, 25, 30? There are 37 references in Islamic sources on these satanic verses. And I'll just quickly tell you of how many are there. We have for this story, 6 go back to Kabal Qureshi. This is as per Shadab, who is a Harvard scholar. He did a dissertation. His PhD is on, he is a Muslim, but his dissertation is on the satanic verses, and there are the references are given. And 5, who's this Ka'b al-Qurazi was one of Islam's earliest Quranic scholars. 5 go back to Urwa ibn al-Zubair, an early Meccan scholar who is also known as the founder of the study of the life of Muhammad. He was also Aisha's nephew, Abu Bakr's grandson, and the son of Abu Bakr's daughter Asma. And he was one of the first one of the first 20 converts to Islam. So he had no reason to lie. And then 2 go back to Abu Bakr, Ibn Abd al-Rahman, Ibn al-Harith, who was one of the top scholars in Islamic law of the first century. 5 go back to Abu al-Aliyah. 2 go back to al-Sudi, who's earlier another early scholar. 1 go back to the tafsir of Muhammad. And 4 reports go back to Qatada, Ibn Dama. 1 go back to al-Dahalak. Again, these are all first century experts of Islam, first century scholars of Islam, first century. 1 go back to Ikrimah, who's a slave of Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas was there, who's a cousin of Muhammad himself. So this is the earliest, it is a continued, it's a standard element in the earliest historical memories of the Islamic community. It was not written by a Jew, it was not written by a Christian, it was not written by the West, you know, the evil West. America was not there at that time. So this was done, this was Shadab Ahmad, a Harvard scholar in Islamic studies. So here we also see the principle of Islamic of embarrassment. Now I salute the Muslim scholars who had the guts to write this in their books. That is, this actually happened. And because this is like, this is one of the historical methods of the principles of embarrassment. And the great Oxford scholar Guillaume says, it is impossible.
Yeah.
It is impossible to suggest a person that would induce early Muslims to write such a story about Prophet unless it were true.
Yeah, time up. Yeah, 2 minutes of your explanation. Sides up.
Yes, again I say the same thing, that all the narration which speaks about its satanic verses are fabricated. It is not true. Whether it is Suyuti, whether anybody else, it is not with a proper chain. Once you have a hadith from a fabricated chain, many people, they copy it, and many people, they mention it. So fabricated chain cannot be accepted. So it is a well-established fact that it was all the hadith which speaks about satanic verses, about that, it is fabricated, it is not true. I am reading Surah Najm, the same verse. Can you, if I read that verse, can you gather the same thing that it was from Satan? By the star when it goes down, your companion is neither astray nor being misled. Now it says about companion not misled, and you are saying Satan misled him. This is absolutely false. Nor does he say aught of his own desire. Now you say that he was speaking the desire of Satan. How can it be desire of Satan when it says that nor does he say aught of his own desire? It is no less than an inspiration sent down to him. He was taught by one mighty in power, endued with wisdom, for he appeared in the stately form while he was in the highest part of the horizon. Then he approached and came closer and was at a distance of but 2 paw lengths or even nearer. So did Allah convey the inspiration to his servant, conveyed, and he means to convey. The prophet's mind and heart in no way falsified that which was that which he saw. Quran is saying that prophet's mind was not falsified that which he saw, and you say that Satan falsified his mind. Will he then dispute with him concerning what he saw? For indeed he saw him at a second descent near the law tree, beyond which none may pass. Near it is the garden of abode. Behold, the law tree was shrouded in mystery unspeakable. His sight never swerved, nor did it go wrong. So all the while Quran is praising Prophet Muhammad that he did not go wrong, his mind was not possessed, and you say that Satan influenced him. For truly did he see of the signs of the Lord, of his Lord the greatest. Have you seen Lat and Uzza, and another the third goddess Manat? What for you the male sex and for him the female? Behold, such would be indeed a division most unfair. So when you read the verses in context, you are confirmed that no Satan can influence Prophet Muhammad.
Yeah, thank you. 2 minutes for you. Naren sir.
Okay, now audience, my dear audience, did you see the tap dancing which is done by Dr. Syed over here? He said, okay, Muhammad writes a book, look at the circular logic. When I was investigating Christ, some of my closest friends are Muslims and many of them tried me to convert me also. And what really shocked me was the circular logic. So Muhammad writes a book. In his book, he writes, he's the best. And then if somebody asks him, he says, refer to the book, and the book says, I'm the best. So in the book, he writes, he cannot be influenced. So that means he cannot be influenced. That is the first thing, circular logic. Please learn. Second thing is that if you read Quran chapter 22, verse 52 to 53, your books, never did we send a prophet, merchant or a prophet before thee, but when he framed a desire, Satan threw some vanity into his desire, but Allah will cancel anything that Satan throws in, and Allah will confirm his signs, for Allah is full of knowledge and wisdom. This verse, if you read the Sirah, if you read the Tafsirs, this was released after the satanic verses to cancel the satanic verses. So your Allah says, Muhammad spoke this. Muhammad accepted that he spoke the satanic verses. Now you are trying to correct Allah, just like Zakir Naik who tried to correct Allah and Muhammad. Come on, Shoaib Sahib, you are a Salafi. You are a Wahhabi. Come on, how can you do this? Okay, maybe you are smarter than Allah. I don't know, maybe you are. Because you do seem to be smarter than Allah. Okay, now coming to the other point, that is whether it is there in the hadith or not, I'll quickly read one or two hadith and move on from there. One sec. Volume number, Sahih al-Bukhari, volume number 2, book number 19. This is Sahih Hadith. You are a Salafi. You cannot say Sahih Hadith is wrong. On what basis are you saying? People will, your own qawm will come after you. Your own ummah will be after you. So, volume number 2, book number 19. Hadith number 177, narrated by Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas, there is one isnad that goes back to Ibn Abbas about the satanic verses. Are you saying that even the cousin of Muhammad was stupid, or was he wrong? He said Muhammad said it. Now coming here, narrated by Ibn Abbas, the prophet prostrated while reciting An-Najm, and with him prostrated the Muslims, the pagans, the jinns, and all the human beings. So why did they prostrate?
Yeah, time up.
They were all opposed to him. Why did they prostrate? Okay, there are so much more. Maybe the next time, Dr. Syed, if you wish.
Sure. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for keeping up the time. And thank you so much for... And audience, please make a note of this. This is a real academic debate. This is about, you know, knowing the books and bringing the content of the books in front of you and trying to present each members of each guest their own case, their own understanding of what it is. So please don't take it as the stand of this channel or stand of any other religion or stand of each other religion, etc., etc. This is personally two persons speaking from their own understanding of the scriptures that they are given with. So try to take it to that academic level. Try to put it to that academic level only. Now it's time for Syed Saab to ask the question. In 1 minute.
Okay. Then you answering the question asked by Muslims, I didn't ask in my presentation. Where did Jesus say, I am God and worship me? You counter question me asking the first question, where did Jesus say, I am prophet and do not worship me? Meaning, if he did not say worship me, he also did not say, do not worship me. So the conclusion is, we can worship him. What a rubbish logic. Abraham, Moses, and all the prophets, even they did not say, do not worship me. Most people in the world did not say, do not worship me. Mr. Narendra Sahu, so should we start worshiping all of them? This is utter rubbish. So your logic doesn't work like this. That if he didn't say, do not worship me, so you should worship him. So should we start worshiping all of them? This is utter rubbish.
Yeah, I hope you understand the question. So it's about appealing to the logic that you used as not a valid logic, and you have 5 minutes to rebut that. Naren Singh Sao.
Okay, first of all, that was a rhetorical question. It is to counter the stupid claim made by Muslims, which says that show me where you know, this is your mentor's favorite question. Show me where Jesus said, I'm God, worship me, and I'll become a Christian. So this was a counter question to that. So Muslims ask a stupid question. So I was following the diktat of the book of Proverbs, where he says that ask a stupid question, a stupid question, and you know that he's not as smart as he thinks he is. So that is the reason I asked that. So no one in the world that I know of, at least, who would say that, okay, I worship Jesus Christ because he said, he never said, I'm a prophet, do not worship me. No one says that. I not one where I challenge you to show me in my presentation where I said, because of that I did that. Now, I gave the presentation. Now, I made an entire presentation on something called as hands, where Jesus, that is the basis of the deity of Jesus Christ. Where Jesus shares the honor due to God, Jesus shares the attributes of God, Jesus shares the names and descriptions of God, Jesus shares the deeds, work or actions of God, which is the creator, sustainer, forgives sins, he's a redeemer, he's a savior. And he applies even the Old Testament verses to himself. And then Jesus shares the seat of the throne of God. So that was the basis. It was not nowhere. You misrepresented. Because see, understand, Dr. Syed, unfortunately, I understand your position, because unfortunately, you being a Muslim, you are used to reading the Quran in bits and pieces. You know, there is the Quran is nothing more than, you know, verses just put together, no sequence in place. The first chapter is not the first chapter, and the first verse is not the first verse of the Quran. There are type things, you know, it is somewhere else. So here the Bible is following a sequence. There is a logic associated. And so what you've done is that, as always, the way you read the Quran, you understood what I said. I was speaking in sequence. That was a rhetorical question made. Now, I had given H, A, and D, S, honor, attributes, names, deeds, and seeds. So he proved that he is God. I even answered your question on John chapter 8, verse 58, where he said, Jesus said, I am. And it was not just saying, I am, so I said, I am, so I am God. No, Jesus said, before Abraham, I am. And he used that in the present tense. Before Abraham was, I am. So the way the God of the Bible says, I am the God of, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, even after Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob has died. And God also says that I'm the God of the living, not of the dead. So in the mind of God, they're all alive. They're all there. He's beyond space and time. Again, a concept that you will not understand because you follow 1, 2, 3, 4 level down, Allah. So once you go up 1, 2, 3, 4 and an infinite number of steps in the saving grace of Lord and Jesus Christ, you'll understand what God is all about. So here he says, before Abraham was, I am. And immediately look at the Jews' response. They said, You are not even 40 years old. And you are saying that you are there with Abraham. So they understand that he is blaspheming and he picked up stones to throw at him. Though that is the collective evidence based on which a Christian accepts the divinity of Jesus Christ. It's not like, as I said earlier, the circular logic of Muhammad, where Muhammad says that I am the final prophet. And no, there is no other prophet after me. And then he says, I am the best, writes it in a book. And then if somebody asks, who gave the book? He says, God gives me the book. Okay, who says you are the best? The book says, you are the best. I am the best. Read the book. But who wrote the book? Muhammad wrote the book. No one heard the voice of Allah. Muhammad claimed to have heard the voice of Gabriel, but he wanted to kill himself. Just think about it. He wanted to kill himself as soon as he heard the voice of Gabriel, the first suicidal prophet in history. He was demon-possessed. You just accepted that he was demon-possessed for some time. So what I ask you, again, coming back to the same thing, show me the verses from the Quran which needs to be removed, or the verses that were removed when he was under the demon possession. It was at least for a period of 6 months as per the Sahih Hadith. So please understand, the Christian understanding of the divinity of Jesus Christ is not based on a jumla. You understand? It is based on an empirical evidence being presented in the life, works, and the historical presence of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Thank you. Time up. Sides up. 5 minutes.
No, you did not answer my question when I said that you counter me. You counter question me asking the first question. Where did Jesus say, I am prophet and do not worship me? The argument is that if he did not say worship me, he did not say do not worship me also. So the obvious conclusion is that we can worship him now because he didn't say do not worship me. This is a rubbish logic, and you agree this is a rubbish logic. I go to that one. But Jesus did consider himself a prophet of God and did say in vain they worship me. John chapter 4 verse number 44. For Jesus himself testified that a prophet hath no honor in his own country. Which prophet he's speaking about? He's speaking about himself. He considered himself a prophet of God. So here you have that Jesus considered himself a prophet of God. Now about do not worship me. Matthew chapter 15 verse number 9. But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines. But in vain they do worship me means that you do not worship, you should not worship me. In vain they worship me. So you have both the phrases that Jesus was a prophet of God, and John chapter 4 verse number 44 says that he was a prophet of God. Matthew chapter 15 verse number 9, he says, do not worship me. Jesus saying, but in vain they do worship me. So Mr. Ennis, do you agree? Your first question is answered. Your first question is answered. Now in the same breath you say, you said about honor, as for honor, that and quoting and referring to John chapter 5 verse 23, that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son, honoreth not the Father, which hath sent him. Why we should honor the Son? Because he was sent by God. Because he was sent by the Father. Therefore, you should honor him. If you honor Jesus, you are honoring Father. If you don't honor Jesus, if you are not honoring Father, because he was the messenger, he was sent by God, therefore you should honor him. Honoring Jesus as you honor God does not make him God. It doesn't say honor Jesus equal to God. It doesn't say honor Jesus equal to God. Can you have for God honor in this world and no honor in the heavens above? Impossible. I repeat, can you have for God honor in this world and no honor in the heavens above? This is impossible. Jesus had no honor in his own country. John chapter 4, verse number 44. He is deficient having honor. God cannot be deficient in receiving honor. For in honor, Jesus is not equal to God. Imagine, Praveen visits your home with his dog Tommy. I repeat, imagine Praveen visits your home with his dog Tommy. And you honor the Tommy as you honor Praveen. Will that entitled Tommy, the dog, to become a man like Praveen? Come on, Narendra Sahu, don't make the dog Tommy into like Praveen. And again, you spoke about first chapter of Quran, it's not like that. What was the first book written in the New Testament? Which book came in first in the New Testament? The letters of Paul came into existence first in 15 to 20 years period of time after Jesus. So letters of Paul was first. where it is placed, where the letters of Paul is placed. It is placed towards the end. Which gospel was the first gospel came into existence? Mark's gospel was the first gospel that came into existence, but it is the second gospel. So you have haphazard arrangement in your Bible. Don't talk about Quran. Quran was revealed to Prophet Muhammad, and it was instructed which verse should be which place, which verse should be in which chapter, which surah should come first, which surah should come last. It was revealed in detail. So don't compare the Bible with Quran. Now, before Abraham was I am. I know before Abraham was I am, you say, but I am you took as name. I am in Hebrew is ho or yah. And I am in Greek is ego emi. These are not names. Names do not translate. So you say that if before Abraham was I am, it is in present tense. So it is not in it is in present tense, but in the Bible you have many people who are before their birth. Solomon is before their birth, before the creation of the heavens and the earth. Solomon was before in Proverbs. Then in Melchizedek, without end, without beginning, without ending, without path, without descent, without without ascent, no beginning, no end. Melchizedek, the king of the priest. So Jeremiah chapter 1 verse number 5, Jeremiah was existing before his own birth. So many people, many personalities in the Bible are before their birth. So if Jesus was before Abraham, then many people were before the earth, before the heaven. So this makes them God again.
Right. Thank you, Shrub sir. Thank you. 2 minutes of explanation or rebuttal from your side. Naren.
Again, you know, inconsistency is the surest sign of a failed argument. This is actually funny. I told again in my previous, you can just go back and see. I'm sure the audience can see what was happening. And you just go back and see and you will see that I had said very clearly that this was rhetoric. I was giving you rubbish because your team, Zakir Naik, your boss, gives rubbish. Give me a single statement where Jesus says, I am God and I'll worship. And so I turned the statement back on you. My argument on divinity was not based on that. Secondly, you said about honor. Now, if Tommy is behaving, is having the all the you know qualities of a human being, if Tommy gets up and speaks and has the same authority, is able to do the same things that Praveen does, then obviously, by any definition, it's not a dog. It is something closer to a human being. And that is what it is. So it is not just about honor. And let me read the chapter back to you. Because see, again, I'll come back to the last point also. John chapter 5 verse 32, 5 verse 25, you spoke about it. Honor the. So before that, that was in John chapter 5 verse 23. And if you start from verse 20, for the Father loves the Son and shows him all his stars. And yes, to your amazement, he'll show him even greater things than these. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, even so the Son gives life to whom he is pleased. He is pleased. Do you understand? This is written in sequence. This is not the Quran, a jumble of rubbish verses. This is about sequential reading, chronological reading. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son. That all, then he says why? That all may honor the Father just as they honor the Son, just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. No other prophet, nobody has spoken like this. Now coming to your, now going ahead, I tell you that truth over here, fears over and believes him is the one who sent me as eternal life, will not be condemned. Jesus says that if you believe in me, you will not be condemned.
Right. Thanks. Yeah, 2 minutes for you, Shoaib sahab.
Now, John chapter 5 verse 23 says that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. Why he should be honored? Because he was sent by God. And I quoted you, John chapter 4, verse number 44, that he's deficient, that he has no honor in his own country. So Jesus is not in honor equal to God. Can you have for God honor in this world and no honor in the heavens above? This is impossible. Jesus had no honor in his own country. Why you are missing that? John chapter 4, verse number 44 says that he was deficient in having honor in his own country. God cannot be deficient in receiving honor. God cannot be deficient. So Jesus is not equal in honor compared to God. No, this is not true. So Jesus is not God. So by honoring Jesus, if I honor you, will you become superhuman being? No, you will be if I honor you, you will be human being only. If I honor the Tommy, if I honor Tommy, Tommy will remain Tommy. He will not become a human being by honoring. So Mr. Narendra Sahu, Tommy will not become a Praveen. The dog cannot become a man like Praveen. So this is not true, that by honoring Jesus, you honor God. By honoring Jesus, you honor God, but by honoring Jesus, you don't become God. You remain a messenger of God. Father which has sent him. Father which has sent him means that he's the messenger of God. So it is more than enough.
Well, thank you very much for, we covered about 4 questions now, and thank you so much for joining us this evening. And since we are running out of the time, let me give 5 minutes of each just to summarize all the 4 questions and, you know, give their reflections on those 4 questions, how the answers went on, and then we can call it a day. Over to you. The first question was asked by Naren Singh Sahu, so I will give the time to Naren Singh himself. 5 minutes of summarizing the entire thing.
Okay, yeah, we are running short of time. Okay, great. Thank you, Praveen. So thank you again, Dr. Syed, for a wonderful presentation, and I really hope that you'll come back for the next installment. So in starting, I showed about the pagan practices of Islam, and there was nothing that Dr. Syed really had to say on that, except but just shaking his head that no, there is nothing pagan in Islam. Everything is Sabian, from the Sabians, from the Zoroastrians, the practices are taken. Even circumcision was a perverted practice adopted by the Egyptians. So Islam is nothing more than a Chinese copy of pagan practices all around that that Muhammad simply picked up. And with regards to, again, the he simply said that now, if you honor, if you honor Tommy as Praveen, then will the dog become like Tommy? So in that case, I did not just depend on that. If the Tommy has all the rights of Praveen, then of course we have to think about how can a dog start behaving like this. And that's where Christians thought about it, and they saw that no, he's exuding all the divine characteristics. So now you speak about John chapter 4 verse 24, where he speaks about a prophet has no honor in his country. Oh, great. So I don't honor Allah. So is Allah, so by your own criteria, Dr. Syed, you have accepted that Allah is a false god. Because he was not honored in his own country. So this is Allah's country, Allah's world and everything, right? You believe in that. I don't honor Allah at all. Allah is a false god by your criterion. So, and then again, you quoted Matthew chapter 15, verse 9. Then this was where Jesus Christ of verse 7, he's saying, you hypocrites, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. Jesus is quoting a prophecy made by Isaiah. And he says, they worship me in vain. Their teachings are nothing but rules taught by men. And this is what Islam is all about. You are nothing more than a bunch of rules. You do five pillars of Islam, and you can do whatever heck you want to do in your life. You can lie, cheat, murder, rape, commit adultery, because again, adultery is incentivized by Allah. And so once you do that, then everything is fine, because you did the 5 times and you are reading the namaz 5 times in a day, which is again a pagan practice. It was by the Sabians. And you go for hajj, that is again a Sabian practice. And you circumambulate is again a Hindu practice. And again, by the pagans of that time, it was there. You are going around as far as the number of planets in the system. So here Jesus Christ is talking about matters of the heart. And he says, and if you read from verse 3 onwards, and he says that if a man says to his mother, whatever you might otherwise might have received from me is a gift devoted to God, he is not to honor his father with it. Thus you nullify the word of God for the sake of your tradition. And that is what you have done. You have nullified the word of God that's been received through your Lord and Savior, my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, because of your traditions that you have received from your Sunnah, Dr. Syed. And this is what you see, that Allah is not God. Muhammad is a fake prophet. And I invite you in the saving grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And again, then we see that in John chapter 15, verse 9, as Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. And towards the end of whatever I did last, there was also the satanic verses, and I have quoted all the sections, and I invite Dr. Syed again to take that question up again the next time, and I will show many more areas in which the Muhammad spoke under the influence of Satan. Allah came in to rescue Muhammad, but not immediately, came after some time. And then again, he was under the satanic influences. And Shoaib Sahib has not yet been able to identify which verses are actually from Satan and which actual verses are from Allah, or whether Allah is himself Satan. So that concludes my presentation. I really hope that Dr. Syed would be here again. I look forward to this invigorating discussion. Thank you again.
Yeah, thank you. Over to you, Syed Saab. 5 minutes of summary.
Yes, Narendra Sahu, you talk rubbish. Whatever you say that Allah is not God and Prophet Muhammad is a fake prophet is a false thing. I can prove to you that Quran is a revelation from God. God of the Bible, God of the Quran is true God, and Prophet Muhammad is a true messenger of God. You said that rituals are pagan practice. These are not pagan practice. Abraham, Moses, Joshua, Jesus, angels, all did fell on their faces and pray to God. This is how they fell on their faces and pray to God. So how can you say these are pagan practice? Muslims, they fall on their faces and pray to God. This is not a pagan practice. Exodus chapter 40 verse 31, Moses and Aaron, they performed the ablution. Muslims performed the ablution. This is not a pagan practice. Zephaniah chapter 3 verse number 9 speaks about a pure language. We Muslims all pray in one pure language, that is Arabic. We all pray in one language. And we call the name of, and that they may call upon the name of the Lord. Who calls the name of the Lord 5 times daily in the Azan? Who calls out Azan, call for prayer 5 times daily throughout the world? It's on continuously. Muslims do that. To serve him with one unison, Shechem, shoulder to shoulder. And who prays joining shoulder to shoulder in the mosque but Muslims? So these are not pagan practice. I gave you references from the Bible that these are not bowing, prostration, raising hand. All is there in Nehemiah chapter 8, verse number 4 to 6. Psalms chapter 84, verse number 4 to 6, spoke about Bakka. Quran chapter 3, verse number 96, also speaks about Bakka. Inna awwala baytin wudiya linnasi lilladhi bibakkatin mubarak. Bibakka, Bakka. Indeed, the first house of worship established for mankind was that at Bakka, blessed and guided for the whole world. So are these pagan practices? This is not pagan practices. You don't have any explanation to all this. Safa Marwa, running between Safa Marwa, was done by Hajra, wife of Prophet Abraham. So it is not a pagan practice. It is a simulation of Hajra, wife of Prophet Abraham. It is not a pagan practice. Muharram, it is not a pagan practice. It is in remembrance of Moses. Jews were fasting on the day of remembrance of Moses. Prophet made it recommended to fast 2 days in remembrance of Moses. So fasting in the remembrance of Moses is not a pagan practice. So how, from where you get the pagan practice? Jesus was circumcised and Prophet Paul circumcised Timothy. How can you say that it's a pagan practice? Jesus was circumcised himself. When he was 8 days old, he was circumcised and named Jesus when he was in mother's womb. Luke chapter 2 verse number 21. So was Jesus pagan? No, Jesus was not pagan. He was prophet of God. So it is not paganism, it is from prophet of God. Genesis chapter 17 verse number 13, 14. It is not that only Jew has to be circumcised. He that is born in thy house and he that is bought with thy money, the person who is bought can be other than Jew. So it is not necessary to be Jew, must needs be circumcised. And my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant. It doesn't say that only the Jews. It doesn't say the Bani Israel. It says, my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant. And the uncircumcised man child whose flesh of his skin is not circumcised, that soul shall be cut off from his people. He hath broken my covenant. This is token of covenant. Muslims have it. Christians do not have it. Christians are under covenant. Christians are not under covenant because they are not circumcised. Muslims are under covenant because they are circumcised. Is this a pagan practice? This is not a pagan practice. You said that circumambulation was practiced by people, by pagan practice. Circumambulation was not practiced by pagans. Circumambulation was started by Prophet Moses, Prophet Abraham. Let me give you the verse. See, chapter 22, Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 26-27. And remember when we showed Abraham the site of the sacred house, saying, associate not anything in worship with me, and sanctify my house for those who circumambulate it. and those who stand up for prayer, and those who, so circumambulation was started by Abraham Pigapani. Kaaba was built by Abraham and Ishmael, and they started circumambulation on command by Allah, the Almighty. It was not taken from the pagans. Pagans before Prophet Muhammad continued the practice of tawaf, but absolutely naked. Islam continued the practice started by Abraham and did not take up any practice of nakedness of the pagans. So Islam is against paganism, not at all close to it. So don't say that circumambulation was started by pagans. Pagans only continued it. Then you say that namaz and namaskar, prostration, is a prostration, is like the same namaskar. We have already seen the prostration by the prophet, no need to repeat it. Abraham, Moses, Aaron, Joshua, Jesus, religious people, they all come on the field and pray.
Yeah, time up, Sayyid Saab. Thank you. Thank you very much.
What I realized that only four questions were taken up, so it will take 44 Sundays. So I cannot wait for 44 Sundays. I'm going to reply all his allegations in a video, and inshallah, I will give it to you, and he can reply my video once he has it. Okay.
Yeah, sure. That's a better idea. Anyways, thank you very much, gentlemen, both of you to join. Both of you from northern part of India, central northern part of India. Thank you very much for that. And there were some people who called us and they asked if the discussion can happen in Hindi also, so that people, a lot of followers from both the sides can also listen to this discussion in Hindi. But for the general audiences and for the international reach purposes, we kept it in English. But keep that in your mind, and if you know anybody in Hindi who would like to come forward and represent the same topic in Hindi language, please let us know. You can see the telephone numbers to contact us on the screen, and let us know if there are people in Hindi to come forward and defend these same topics. And we will definitely like to get people from the Christian perspective also to speak in Hindi. So for the audiences, as I mentioned earlier, this is an academic debate, and take it with the same spirit, the spirit of academic excellency, and nothing more and nothing less. And with another topic, with another very good discussion, we'll be in front of you very soon. And keep praying, keep continuing, keep supporting Rakshana Television, and it's your voice and your vision that we are carrying it forward. Thank you so much, and thank you all of those who participated as audiences, and all of those who participated as prayer warriors behind this program. Thank you so much, and I'll meet you again on Saturday. Thank you.